Mari mari adik,
mari mari abang,
mari kita berdendam si pinang muda.
Maligai bahagiamu telah kuruntuhkan. Dara bukan gadis lagi.
At the height of his career in the 50s and 60s, P. Ramlee was hailed as Asia's Charlie Chaplin.
Ia bukan insan seni penyulap harta negara. Ia bekalkan pusaka lebih berharga, bermaruah bagi bangsanya.
Because to me, P. Ramlee is only my father. Tapi he belongs to everybody. Itu saja saya punya pegangan.
He acted in 66 films, directed 35, and wrote 33 of them, as well as having composed over 360 songs in his lifetime.
P. Ramlee punya film sentiasa laku. Jangan 100 tahun pun boleh laku.
Conquering every medium of the entertainment spectrum, P. Ramlee had an infinite charm, laced with a healthy dose of humor, warmth, and humility that endeared him to many. But his phenomenal rise from stagehand to screen sensation had ill prepared him for the downward spiral to rejection and obscurity.
Dia sedih pasal dia datang di balik di my own country, dia kata, people tak appreciate dia.
But after death, his popularity soared to incredible heights. On the 29th of May, 1973, legendary Malaysian screen icon P. Ramlee dies, broke and broken.
Apa salah dia? Itu kataan yang cakap dia cakap. Dia tanya dia, adakah people will remember me? Kan? Dia tak boleh faham jiwa dia. Dia tak boleh buat apa waktu itu.
His sudden death at age 44 is greeted with disbelief and shock around Malaysia and throws the country into sadness and confusion.
Banyak orang nangis. India, Kutumayang, Ratang Putih, Cina jual sayur. Saya tanya, kenapa lu nangis sampai ini macam? Ini orang banyak baiklah, dia banyak tolong saya. Kenapa dia mati, kenapa Tuhan Allah ambil sama dia?
Within hours, glowing tributes start to swamp the media.
Tidak ada di Asia dan saya rasa tidak ada di dunia pun yang saya kenal dalam dunia perfilman. Tidak ada tokoh seperti P. Ramlee ini.
But unwanted and unloved by his own people in the years up to his death, guilt begins to prick a nation's collective conscience.
Wah, inilah dia gambar yang dia nak sunting.
His films and songs had grossed millions of dollars and swept more than 30 awards Asia-wide.
Allah kasih.
Ini kebiasaannya. Masa seseorang tu masih hidup memang tidak dipedulikan. Memang apabila dia meninggal baru kita tahu, baru kita sedar bahawa apa yang dia buat tu meninggalkan sesuatu khazanah yang sukar untuk kita menidakkan.
Mengapakah kau diciptakan Allah menjadi manusia?
With regret coming in large doses, there is a clamor for his songs and movies and frenzied calls to have him properly honored and remembered.
Banyak uang, wahai Ali Baba, kacau.
Memorials, roads and buildings are named in his honor, and P. Ramlee is posthumously awarded the Malaysian honorific title Tan Sri, a knighthood in stature. But for a growing number of voices within the entertainment community, it is too little, too late.
Mungkin kalau dia masih hidup, dia dapat Tan Sri ni, saya banggalah, saya kata. Tapi sekarang saya tak rasa apalah. Cuma saya rasa sedih. Sesudahnya dia pergi, baru diagung-agungkan. Masa dia hidup, tak ada orang pedulikan dia.
It's sad, but it's true. You want to be loved, you want to be famous, you have to die first.
Revered as the greatest Malaysian entertainer of the last century, P. Ramlee got his big break at the Shaw Studios on Jalan Ampas in Singapore in the 1940s. Known around Asia as the Warner Brothers of Malaysia, it was here that P. Ramlee started working as a stagehand. Within a few years, P. Ramlee was Shaw Studios' most successful movie maker, writing, directing and starring in a series of box office hits.
Ketika itu P. Ramlee punya nama betul-betul tengah, penjulang tinggi. Orang datang cari dia tu tak berhenti-berhenti. Sampai saya bilang, Ram, tahun ini bukan lu cari duit. Duit datang cari lu.
At the height of his career, P. Ramlee was not only an idol of the entertainment scenes in Malaysia, but had a huge following overseas, most notably Singapore and Indonesia. He was also a popular figure amongst the Japanese film fraternity. And in a period where Hindi movies ruled the Malaysian box office, Ramlee's films rocked the status quo for the first time in decades.
Dia memang selalu dia nak meninggikan mutu kesenian bangsa kita lah. Dia selalu, umpamanya kalau nak buat filem pun, dia selalu nak bikin filem yang bercorak macam kemelayuan ya. Kalaupun lagu pun gitu.
The man whose films, music and charisma inspired and touched the hearts of millions seemed untouchable. But Ramlee was more than just an actor. He was a man of vision. Knowing that color films were the way forward, making his first screen movie in color became an obsession for the next couple of years.
Jadi orangnya advance tau eh. Macam 10-20 tahun dia boleh tahu.
In 1965, after completing his last successful film for the Shaw Studio, Singapore, Ramlee left to join Merdeka Film Studio in Kuala Lumpur. For the next 7 years, Ramlee made 18 films with Merdeka Studio, none of which had the box office success of his earlier films. Recording companies, which had profited so much from his sweat and tears, turned their backs on him.
Ramlee hanya ada kontrak di Singapura, jadi saya pergi tanya Mrs. B untuk kontrak baru lah. Mrs. B, tak boleh. Piramidi lagu tak laku.
But even worse, his efforts to recapture his former glory were often ridiculed and vilified by the public and media.
Memang pada masa itu memang Piramidi teruk kena. Ya, apabila dia buat 6 jahanam, ya, lagi teruk dia kena. Pertelagahan Piramidi tu ada kan, dengan wartawan. Wartawan selalu kritik dia kan.
P. Ramlee's triumph and fame had once earned him an iconic status. In his final years, he tried desperately but failed to recapture his former glory. But in death, he became a timeless superstar. Born Tuku Zakaria Nyakpute in Penang Island on the 22nd of March 1929, P. Ramlee rose from humble beginnings. His father, Tuku Nyakpute, was an Indonesian sailor from Aceh who migrated to Malaya. He settled in Penang when he married Cik Ma Hussein, Ramlee's mother. The letter P in P. Ramlee stands for Pute, his father's name. He used this name in a singing competition when he was 17 years old and emerged champion. Believing it brought him luck, he decided to keep it. Educated in Penang, P. Ramlee went to school as a teenager at the Penang Free School.
Saya kawan dengan yang kenal dengan dia masa darjah satu sekolah lagi. Tapi sekolah lain, dia sekolah Melayu Kampung Jawa. Saya sekolah Melayu Perak Road.
His faithful friend Sukardi remembers going everywhere with the irrepressible Ramli.
Lalu di Penang selalu kami berdua ronda sana ronda sini. Basikal dia satu saja basikal, saya tak nak basikal. Naik dua.
A cheeky daredevil teen, Ramli was always up to mischief wherever he went.
Jadi apa yang ada pokok jambu, pokok kedondong, pokok apa, kalau Ramli sampai saja, tinggal daun dia. Putik-putik semua dia angkat. Ramli main nakai masa yang kecil-kecil. Kami di rumah makcik saya tu meja panjang ni, dia balik sekolah, dia boleh stand tu. Dia pula sini, sampai hujung meja. Mak saya kata, Ramli yang apa lah nak pergi jahanam ke, tak ada apa. Dia turun, dia stand lagi. Cukup tiga kali stand, cukup. Arwah Miahan, saya sayang sungguh dekat dia.
Composer and musician Datuk Ahmad Nawab, who went to school with Ramli, recalls seeing him in a scuffle.
Saya same school dengan dia, Francis Light School. Saya panggil dia budak keroncong. Saya selalu main bola itu. Saya tengok dia ada orang duk bergaduh tu. Bergaduh, saya pun pergi tengok ramai orang keliling lah, macam tengok boxing ya. Saya tengok Firamli ni bergaduh dengan satu orang Cina dengan bertumbuk lah. Kalau saya tengok muka dia, ada kena pisau kat sini. Ada bekas pisau di muka dia. Parut dia, tapi bila dia dah gemuk kan, dah tak apa nampak lah. Waktu dia kurus tu boleh nampak.
But the wayward teenager's destiny was changed by a simple twist of fate. Ramli was about 14 when the Japanese invaded and occupied Malaya from 1941 to 1945 during the Second World War. The Japanese left free movie tickets at post offices in the town centers to entice Malayan youths into their naval camps. It wasn't long before Ramli and Sukardi got hold of those tickets. To their disappointment, it was a Japanese propaganda movie. But that wasn't the only surprise in store for the mischievous teens. At the end of the movie, they were forced into a waiting truck and ended up as instant recruits of a Japanese naval college. It was this stint at the college that taught P. Ramli to speak fluent Japanese, play the violin, and later influence his disciplined work style.
Malam-malam bila seminggu dua kali mesti rai atau mengajar lah violin. Lepas graduate, saya pergi bahagian Jepun punya signal. Signal bendera lah. Dia pasal pandai drone, dia masuk bahagian torpedo.
Even while Japanese soldiers were committing atrocities outside their college walls, the two teenagers formed an attachment to the Japanese officers in the college who were good to them.
Dengar di luar-luar saja lah Jepun yang kejam tu, masa sekolah kami tak ada. Jepun serendah dengar semasa dalam training, malam lah kami dengar. Dengar radio, jadi kami masuk store. Semua pedang-pedang Jepun saya dengan Ramli ambil. Semua ni. Tapuk-tapuk semua ni lah. Takut dia orang Jepun harakiri.
Three years after the end of the Second World War, P. Ramli and Sukardi were spotted performing at an agricultural fair in Penang by B.S. Rajans, a director with the Shaw Studio. He invited both of them to audition as musicians at the studio and left them two train tickets to Singapore. The two friends, who had never been out of Penang, decided to accept the invitation and try their hand at show business. They set off for Singapore on the morning of the Eid Muslim festival that marks the end of the fasting month. P. Ramli remembered the excitement of celebrating Eid on a train for the first time.
Saya masih teringat pada 8 hari bulan Ogos tahun 48. Itu hari yang mula-mula saya keluar dari Pulau Pinang menuju ke Singapura untuk bermain film. Adalah hari raya yang pertama. Dan pada hari itu, saya merayakan Hari Raya Aidil Fitri di dalam kereta api. Jadi saya dapat melihat banyak negara, banyak negeri berhari raya. Dari Pulau Pinang terus ke Singapura.
Dulu kereta api pun takkan tak tahu bangsa asapnya, pakai arangnya. Muka dia hitam-hitam, cuci mata. Dia pergi take class. Jadi kami turun-turun, cuci-cuci muka semua, barulah makan.
But with little money, the two young hopefuls were living on excitement and adrenaline, not luxuries, as Sukardi vividly remembers about their accommodation.
Bukan beli tempat tidur, beli store. Selam dua hari kami pun pilih sekretaris.
Action!
A week after their auditions, Sukardi, who was unsuccessful, returned home to Penang. But Ramli, who was still hopeful of an acting offer, settled for odd jobs as clapperboy, stagehand, and later as playback singer. Ramli's patience finally paid off when at age 19, he was given his first screen debut in a supporting role as the villain in the film Cinta. Former actor and crooner, the late Datuk Ahmad Daud, recalled watching the film with friends in Penang.
Bila dia buka baju dalam gambar cerita, kita ni member bergelak. Siapa? Bila dia angkat tangan tu, Piram ni, terlang, tang, 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 tulang, tulang kering punya kuih. Dengan dia punya, apa, pipi tu, apa, orang panggil macam tonjol ke depan tu, jawab batu, kuih. Bahkan bila dia menyanyi pula, kita nak tergelak. Ay, awak suara lain. Menyanyi sayang, cuma mula.
Datuk L. Krishnan was one of the few Indian directors hired by the Shaw Studio. He gave P. Ramli his first lead role in a drama called Bhakti, much to the shock of the studio people.
Saya gunakan Ramli sebagai hero di dalam Bhakti because he was a singer. So saya pun bilang sama Ramli, lagu-lagu semua jangan kasih hilang.
Ramli's screen impact was so impressive that after Bhakti, Krishnan went on to cast Ramli as the lead in three other films. Their immediate success made P. Ramli a hot property.
He was a good actor. He can't even dance. So I told him, don't worry, I'll keep only up till here. You just walk, you know, walk to rhythm.
Following his first screen test, Ramli befriended comedian Dying Harris, who had helped him in his early years. Ramli soon fell for Harris' daughter, Junaina. But Harris wanted Ramli to marry his older daughter, Junaida, a divorcee. Ramli, who hated confrontations, took the path of least resistance. In early 1950, he married Junaida. His only biological son, Nasir, was born 3 years later. That same year, Ramli won Radio Malaya's Best Male Singer Award with his song Aziza, making him a sought-after actor and singer. Aziza, composed before he became an actor, soon topped the charts and stayed there for over 4 weeks. Ramli rode on the song's massive popularity, with every woman wanting to be Aziza. But the constant attention from his legion of female fans took a toll on their marriage. The next year, Junaida decided she had had enough and left him, leaving Nasir in P. Ramli's care. Despite juggling a rapidly advancing career and looking after Nasir, P. Ramli always found time for other people, as composer Kasim Masdur, a studio messenger boy at the time, remembers.
Tiap-tiap pagi saya mesti kedudukan P. Ramli.
Ketika dia mandi, favorite singer dia naik King Kong. Saya kena main itu yang gramophone yang pakai spring, pakai kunci ya. Yang banyak membimbing saya dalam muzik ni ialah Allahyarham Tan Sri P. Ramli. Dialah yang mengajar saya bagaimana nak tulis lagu dan bagaimana nak membaca not. Lama-kelamaan, dia suruh saya tulis lagu yang dicipta. Dia lantik saya sebagai penolong pengarah muzik dia.
To composer Ahmad Nawab, P. Ramli's extraordinary gift for music more than made up for his lack of formal musical training.
Saya tengok dia pandainya, dia boleh baca note without playing instrument. He can sing. Sekiranya lagu saya dinyanyi oleh P. Ramli, I can say that I'm barulah saya percaya diri saya komposer.
Not long after his divorce from Junaida, P. Ramli was back on the dating scene. Beauty queen Mariani Ismail, who was Miss Singapore 1951, caught his eye.
Kami selalu dating lah. Bila tak syuting aja, dia akan jumpa saya. Bila dah jatuh cinta, dia bilang, saya nak kahwin sama you, dia bilang. Tapi saya tak mau you berlakon. You nak nyanyi boleh. Saya ajar you nyanyi.
P. Ramlee had found the new love of his life. But by forbidding Mariani to become an actress, Ramlee had unwittingly set the stage for his own heartbreak. Mariani was being seriously courted by the Shaw Studios, and someone else had a very special place in her heart. After his divorce from first wife Junaida, P. Ramlee was convinced he had found love again with ex-Singapore beauty queen Mariani. But he didn't want his future wife to be an actress. P. Ramlee was unaware that Mariani was being hotly pursued by film studios, including Shaw Studio, for a film career. And while Ramlee was important to Mariani, she was not prepared to hurt her sister, Saloma, who on her return from Australia had fallen hard for P. Ramlee.
Habis satu malam tu Ramlee datang ambil saya pergi makan, ajak pergi makan. Ramlee dia very romantic. Orangnya suka peluk. Saya tengok Saloma tengok macam terlalu admire.
Mariani could not bear to watch her sister's infatuation. So she decided to sacrifice her own relationship and find a way to steer P. Ramlee into Saloma's arms.
Adik aku tak boleh cari, suami aku boleh cari. Macam mana nak marahkan si P. Ramlee ni kan? Teringat yang dia tak kasih berlakon. Kebetulan jalan nampas, tengah sibuk kat saya. Saya kejam mata, sign kontrak 5 tahun. Saya pergi rumah Ramlee. Saya cakap, Remy, saya panggil dia Remy. Dia panggil saya Mary. Saya cakap, Remy, I dah sign kontrak tau. I nak jadi bintang filem. Peruh mata dia sepet. Telinga dia merah. Oh, mau jadi bintang film ya, dia kata.
Mariani was baffled at P. Ramlee's lack of reaction, but she soon found out why.
Dia pergi kat Mr. Quack. Itu baru punya bintang film Mariam, dia sign contract semalam kan. You jangan kasih masuk dia saya punya set dan saya tak mau berlakon sama dia. You jangan suggest saya berlakon dengan dia. Terus Mr. Quack jumpa saya. Mariam, itu you punya nama sudah tukar ya, Mariani. Itu P. Ramlee tak mau berlakon sama you. Dia tak kasih, jangan pergi masuk set dia tau. Nanti dia terus tak mau syuting, dia mogok nanti. Baiklah. Terus tak tegurlah. Selama 7 tahun.
Ramlee's popularity as a charismatic actor and singer rose with each movie. Ramlee gained a reputation as a bit of a ladies' man. In 1954, 6 years after he started working with Shaw as a stagehand, P. Ramlee was performing before the Sultan and Queen of Perak, North Malaysia. Pleased with the show, the Sultan asked Norizan Muhammad Noor, one of his wives, to catch the show on the second night. Norizan confided in academic Professor Dr. Wan Hashim that the Sultan's orders came with a warning.
Tapi dia beri amaran, Norizan, kamu jangan pandang matanya. Kerana mata P. Ramlee itu magnetik, katanya, ada besi berani, takut jatuh cinta. Norizan pada waktu itu memang tidak begitu berminat dengan P. Ramlee, tapi oleh kerana seperti arahan suaminya, dia pergi menonton.
When Ramlee was introduced to Norizan, there was instant chemistry between them.
Permaisuri berkenalan, terus jatuh cinta kepada P. Ramlee.
Norizan became one of P. Ramlee's biggest fans. Although the distance between Singapore and Perak kept them physically apart, it did not stop them from communicating over the telephone. But P. Ramlee kept his distance, respecting Norizan's status as the Sultan's consort.
Dan suatu percintaan yang cukup sukar, bersembunyi, dan saya diberitahu oleh Norizan bagaimana tuanku mula tahu perhubungan mereka itu ialah kerana bil telefon itu tiba-tiba melonjak naik. Di luar kebiasaan. Di luar kebiasaan ini ada sesuatu.
Their relationship continued to blossom. However, Ramlee was apprehensive about the huge potential for conflict in getting involved with someone of Norizan's status. But it never materialized.
Tak ada gaduh-gaduh, tak ada apa. Sebabnya apa yang Don Norizan bagi tahu sama saya, dia memang Sultan pun sayang dengan Ramlee.
P. P. Ramlee and Norizan were married on February the 6th, 1955. And Ramlee voluntarily stayed away from Perak until the Sultan's demise in 1962. News of Ramlee's marriage to Norizan came as a big blow to Mariani, his former love. She had broken up with him in order to matchmake him with her sister Saloma.
Terkejut saya. Aku dah berkorban gini dia pergi kahwin dengan Norizan. Aku tak dikahwin dengan Saloma. Bila dikahwin dengan Norizan, Saloma merajuk lagi. Dia pergi Melbourne pula. Dia menyanyi lagi, jauh lagi. Bawa diri.
Marriage to Norizan coincided with an exciting phase in P. Ramlee's professional life. In 1956, P. Ramlee played the title role in the historical film Hung Tuah and wrote the music. He won the award for Best Musical Score at the Asia Pacific Film Festival. It was the first international award for Ramlee and Shaw, and Ramlee dedicated one of the film's most popular songs to his new wife, Norizan.
Masuk bulu apa kemudian untuk dia dah kena tinggal kat istana dan kemudian kena membawa segala tidak sebanyak lah ke. Jadi kat dah berkorban kerana Ramli dia tu dia kata Norizan anak karang satu lagi dulu dia kata berkorban aku saja dia kata nyawa tu maknanya kat no dia bermakna juga lah kat no sebagai ada bantu semua.
With Norizan, P. Ramlee's appearance and lifestyle underwent a complete change. She wanted the palace decorum she was used to observed in the family home. Nasir, his son with his previous wife, 8 years old at the time, remembers life with Norizan and his new adopted and step siblings.
Bapa ay makan kami kena disappear. Tak dengar suara pun. Tunggu Norizan panggil. Cacik, dia panggil cacik. Cacik, Norma, Betty, Sazali turun. Baru kami boleh turun. Bilik, empat bilik, tiap-tiap minggu bertukar. Bapak selalu masuk salah bilik.
But it was during his marriage to Norizan that P. Ramlee, the entertainer, was at his most prolific. Some say she was the muse for many of his greatest works. In 1955, 26-year-old P. Ramlee wrote and acted in his directorial debut, Penarik Becha, one of the most memorable films in the history of Malay cinema. It catapulted him into the ranks of more established directors. Featuring his enduring hit song, Aziza, written 10 years earlier, the film won 5 major awards, a result of P. Ramlee's multifaceted skills on the set.
Dia suka art, art of feeling. Macam, kenapa? Macam-macam gitu tau. Dia banyak art lah, dia banyak ajar saya art. Macam, Amran. Macam gitu tau. Dia suka ajar. Orang kalau tak tahu macam Hindustan, tapi art. Aku sedar
miskin. With Malay audiences responsive to films directed by Indian talent, Ramlee had to maintain some traces of Indian flavor in Penarik Becha. Jadi pagar.
Kemudian ada scene-scene yang seolah-olah macam pilih Hindustan, rumah pocor, masuk air dan nasi turun bawah. Itu semua kemahiran pilih Hindustan.
But P. Ramlee was not averse to rocking the status quo. And in his follow-up directorial work, Samira Padi, Ramlee made a film totally devoid of any trace of Indian influence. The film's success was a milestone for Malay films.
Ini diakui sendiri oleh Shaw Brothers. Tidak ada satu filem yang boleh merosakkan filem Hindustan. P. Ramlee seoranglah dibilang yang merosakkan koleksyen filem Hindustan.
P. Ramlee's third film, Pancha Delima, was the only one he directed but did not act in. The script was written by one of the Shaw Brothers. At the preview of the film, attended by Shaw Studios' mostly Indian directors, Run Run Shaw suddenly stopped the show.
Run-Run Shaw duduk depan, tahan, filem tu stop. Buka lampu semua preview room terang. Semua pengarah waktu tu ada dipanggil oleh Run-Run Shaw, termasuk P. Ramlee. Jadi Shaw Brother marah, Shaw Brother bilang, you are director. Satu budak muda boleh buat filem yang baik, kau yang telah banyak pengarah, tak berani ambil filem tu.
Shaw was furious with these more established directors' lack of confidence and reluctance to work on his script. But with Ramli's success, the Shores provided more opportunities for new Malay directors to direct movies for the studio. The stinging rebuke from Shaw, however, had sowed the seeds of discontent amongst directors and actors. In 1957, P. Ramlee walked away with a Best Actor award at the Tokyo 4th Asian Film Festival. This time for his unforgettable performance in the tearjerker Anak Ku Sazali, where he played dual roles of a loving father and a rebellious son.
Satu perbuatan Sadri, bapak yang bertanggung jawab. Oh, bapak mau mengusir Sadri keluar dari rumah ini ya? Bapak tahu.
Actors, workers, and studio staff turned out in full force at the airport to welcome P. Ramlee home from the festival. But as P. Ramlee's popularity soared to a new high, the silence of the press was deafening.
P. Ramlee sudah tak ada apa ni news lagi tentang P. Ramlee. Wartawan-wartawan sudah boikot dia.
His new status as the Shores' golden boy intensified the resentment of established actors and directors who had considerable influence on the press. But Ramlee's career was just beginning, and his critical and box office successes held out the promise of further cinematic brilliance. P. Ramlee continued to enjoy spectacular success with each consecutive film he was involved in. Everything he touched seemed to turn to gold, but the stunning pace of his professional life left him very little time for his family. Norizan began to feel neglected. It was not the life she had envisaged when she gave up the palace for P. Ramlee. But for P. Ramlee, marriage to Norizan inspired such artistic brilliance that he was able to make 12 highly successful films. P. Ramlee's success continued to be a thorn in the side of established directors, actors, and journalists who would use every opportunity to discredit him.
Sebenarnya komplot ni daripada zaman awal lagi. Abang belum pergi ke studio Jelampah lagi. Sebelum tu abang, bila abang pergi, abang dah dengar cerita yang ada satu puak menentang P. Ramlee kerana Shaw memberi layanan macam anak emas kepada P. Ramlee kan.
Sadie Boss kata, what he wants, give it to him. Jangan kata, oh ini tak boleh, itu tak boleh. Oh ini mahal, itu mahal. Tak boleh.
However, this special treatment was not extended to other actors or directors at Shaw Studio. Despite the backstabbing, Ramlee once more stepped into new cinematic territory, writing and acting in his first comedic film. Bujang Lapok was a film about three bumbling but good-hearted bachelors who were always on the lookout for love. Aimi Ja overheard Ramlee telling friends about his new comedy.
Jadi cara dia bercerita tu terasa macam dah tengok wayang. Karena P. Ramlee bila bercerita dengan gerak mata, dengan gerak tangan, dengan nada suaranya, sampai ke shot-shot semua dia bercerita.
Ramlee knew he needed people who were naturally funny to co-star in his first comedy outing. So he picked and indulged comedians Aziz Sattar and S. Shamsuddin to provide rare gems of comic improvisation.
Menyampah. Nanti o bagi batu zahabat di susta. Biar nang buti nang. Kui buti kui butai miri. Sir tom tom.
Kau suka tingkol den. Kau buat kau punya suka sendiri. Saya pun dah takut bila dia cakap gitu. Alamaknya dia dah marah. Jadi dia tengok tu. Ah, cuba rasa lagi sekali. Ah, cuba lain sekali. Belum lagi dia. Belum lagi. Jadi apa yang dia nak tu tadi. Itu yang terkucil tadi kau cakap tu. Itu tu boleh.
Hey Ramlee. Ya. Siapa kau?
The film when it was released was an astounding success.
Kingkong kepala hutan kau. Aku tengah ada belajar dialog. Kau orang bising.
Ha? Dia mengarah orang Sabah. Dia boleh kontrol orang. Tak boleh gini, tak boleh. Tapi saya dengan Sudin, dia tak boleh kontrol. Apa yang saya buat, mesti diikutnya. Yang saya bangga satu, bila saya tengok Bujang Lapok, tidak ada satu yang saya buat, dia buang.
Pakcik, ponet, tekalah nak mandi ni, oi.
P. Ramlee went on to create two more hugely successful sequels to Bujang Lapok. Fresh from the exceptional success of the Bujang Lapok trilogy, Ramlee wrote and directed a parody of Ali Baba and the 40 Thieves, based on the trilogy's characters.
Esok nyising, semer nyising, kape wong potong nyising. Alibaba!
Certain lines from the show, some of them spontaneous improvisations, would go on to make cult status among Malaysian audiences. And although Ramli played the villain for the first time, the film still enjoyed outstanding box office success. New actress Sarima remembers Ramli teasing her on set.
Eh, apa pasal pula pisau melekat belakang aku dah? Aduh,
ada sakit. Dengan ketakutan lah kan, bila masuk jalan set ni yang Piramli nanti menjerit. Timbul, dia kata. Dia kata timbul tu, saya pun tengok dia. Nangis lah air mata keluar. Dan kita datang saya only 17 kan. Tu datanglah apa ni, arwah Sudah Maji ni. Dia kata awak jangan begitu, Ma. Dia kata dia tu bergurau supaya awak hilang darah gemuruh nak syuting ni. Tapi kita mana tahu kan.
Ekstra lalu pun dia ambil berat. Dia kalau berlakon, dia tidak mahu dia satu orang bagus.
Rupanya cantik. Umurnya 18.
But Ramli may have crossed the line with his improvisations. It was almost banned by the censor board for improper depiction of the Arabic language and had to be redubbed with minimal Arabic accent. 300 dirham! P. Ramli went on to win 5 more major international awards from 1958 to 1964, during which he made some of his most popular comedies. But as he became increasingly engulfed by his art, his personal life began to suffer. Cracks began to appear in his marriage, and fights with Nurizan at home became more frequent.
Pincanglah asmara.
Hoping his problems would go away, P. Ramli quickly immersed himself in a new film that took a critical look at the prevailing social class systems in the country. Not for the first time, the film's theme song, composed and sung by P. Ramli, became a bigger hit than the film itself. And while the film was not a big box office draw, it received critical acclaim, validating Ramli as a maestro director. By now, everyone wanted to act in his films, no matter how small the part.
Freddy, abang nak ambil kau berlakon dengan abang. Abang terus cium tangan ni, adik. Terima kasih, abang. Dan saya tak tanya berapa harga bayaran pasal sendakan arahan bawah dia.
Ya, aku datang hendak memisahkan.
Bila dah keluar dekat panggung, barulah orang kenal saya siapa Kusuinata. Jadi ialah guru saya, ia nak kenal nama saya.
His unique directorial style often left a lasting impression on his cast and crew.
Ramli direct teliti, pakai pat cepat. Perasaan orang dah betul, perasaan lambat pun tak apa. Kalau dia boleh tunggu artis tu sampai satu hari satu malam sampai dapat itu shot.
While P. Ramli's career kept soaring, things at home were deteriorating. Nurizan's discontentment with her own marriage made her sensitive to Ramli's working relationships, especially with his female co-stars. So when news reached home of Ramli and former love Mariani rehearsing songs together at the studio, Nurizan flew into a rage. Nasir, who was 8 at the time and living with P. Ramli and Nurizan, remembered that day.
Nurizan ajak eh. Jadi dia ikut mami pergi rumah Mariani. Cik, kami duduk aduk kereta, Nurizan turun. Mar, Mar.
P. Ramli had no idea that the former and current love of his life were about to confront each other for the first time.
Tahu-tahu ada orang badan besar dekat pinggang, tampar saya. Saya cakar dia balik. Lepas saya bilang, trespassing. Get out from my house.
Mariani reported the matter to the police. Eventually, Nurizan apologized in court. Mariani accepted, and the matter was quickly forgotten. But not by Saloma, who had just returned from her stint in Australia. She went after Nurizan.
Dekat studio lah. Saloma sudah datang, birang lah. Oh, dia cakap putih lah.
You slap my sister, never mind. But one day I take your husband.
Saloma, by then an accomplished and popular singer, started performing at stage shows with P. Ramlee. And not long after, she was auditioning and acting in P. Ramlee's movies. Noorizan, desperate to save her marriage, was driven to check up on her husband with the young Nasir in tow.
We spot check, tapi P. Ramlee punya spy lagi terror. Bos datang bos. Oh, P. Ramlee marah apa? Saloma, you acting apa ini cik? Yeah, ni betul ni. You acting apa? Mari tengok.
By 1960, the cracks in their marriage had deepened. Nasir remembered things getting stormy at home.
Diorang kalau bergaduh lebih dahsyat tau ni. Buat tumbuk, buat keris-keris semua. Noorizan dan Ramli. Dia baru kami diam. Tapi tempat pergi angkat. Di klinik depannya. Pengsan.
The marriage was in serious trouble. Rumors of Noorizan's friendship with a younger actor and Ramlee's dalliances with his co-stars pushed the relationship to its limit. And after 6 years together, P. Ramlee and Noorizan divorced. In one of her recorded interviews, Noorizan, who left the palace for him, spoke of her frustrations with P. Ramlee, whose art eclipsed everything else in his life, including her. She felt unloved.
Dia tidak rasa diri kat Anu ni, dia tak ada sayang pada kat Anu. Jadi dia kata, Noorizan, I tak menceraikan you. Dia kata, tapi kalau you nak bercerai juga, okay. Tapi I masih sayang kat you sampai I nyawa dia dalam badan dia bersayang kat Anu. Dia kata, tapi masa tu kat Anu tak boleh nak. Kan tak tahan yang dia buat kat Anu macam tu, macam dia tak sayang, tak kasih dengan kat Anu. Sampai sampai kat Anu berkorban untuk dia keluar daripada tanah, 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 tanah,
tanah, tanah. P. Ramlee himself never spoke of his troubled marriage to Noorizan, who, unwilling to face her family, remained in Singapore after the divorce, before later moving to Kuala Lumpur. After an 8-year hiatus, Saloma was firmly back on the scene, this time making an impression on the twice divorced, much idolized and newly available P. Ramlee. Nasir, who was 9 years old then, recalls Saloma coming to take him out one day. He did not take a liking to her and told his father so.
Nasir suka tanti tu. Idea mah. Sampai aku nak tulis 1,000 kali tu. I must love my auntie, I must not tulis.
Despite his son's resistance to Saloma, P. Ramlee was set on marrying her. He confided in close friend Musalma, swearing her to secrecy.
Dia tak pernah ada secret dengan saya. Tapi tentang Saloma, dia nak kahwin dengan Saloma ni, saya boleh terperanjat ni.
But Ramlee was insistent, asking Musalma to help him arrange a marriage ceremony.
Boleh lah. Tapi ayat saya ingat dia main-main. Jangan bilang sama siapa tau, ni secret tau, ayat nak kahwin dengan Saloma. Dan ayat tu jangan pun ingat, mesti dia tembirang kan ayat juga pasal dia suka bergurau. Dia bilang betul.
Ramlee and Saloma's marriage took everyone by surprise. In one of his interviews, Ramlee said that he married Saloma not for her voice or beauty, but because they were soulmates. For Saloma, there was a fine line between being his soulmate and living with his eccentricities.
Mula-mula dulu saya pelik, baru-baru kahwin tak retilah. Dia ni betul-betul ganjil lah. Saya belum pernah jumpa orang macam apa, macam dia. Dia kalau nak bikin lagu ni tak kira masa. Kadang-kadang dekat bilik mandi tu kan, maaf cakap dekat dalam bilik mandi, dia duduk berjam-jam, dia duduk fikir. Sampai saya pun nak takut. Punya dia karang lagu lah, buat skrip lah, nanti tangan dia macam itu, macam ini.
Saloma embraced her married life with enthusiasm. As it turned out, she got on famously with Nasir.
Masa dia orang gaduh. Dia ambil Saloma gaduh. Dia orang dua gaduh. Yang kaya ai. Siapa dia orang gaduh, dia orang tak tegur. Dia ambil nak minta apa?
Ni guna you lah.
Guna ai. Cik, cakap dengan mama. Mana Didi punya ini. Eh dia aja. Seringgit. Habis jumpa mama. Mama ada message lah mama. Nanti dek mama tu. I call you tau. I love her so much lah. Tu cakap I love her so much.
Saloma was involved in many of P. Ramlee's successful films, but mostly in supporting roles. Where she had no acting role, they featured her exquisite voice. Singing was her first love, and that suited her husband well. Before long, they became the country's very own screen couple.
Kasim selamat. Siapa dia Kasim selamat?
Inspired by his newfound happiness with Saloma, P. Ramlee wrote, directed and acted in Ibu Mertuaku, one of his most highly acclaimed films. The film was not only a huge box office success, its theme songs surpassed the popularity of the film itself.
Masa dia bikin rekaman tu, mak ada kat sana, jadi dengar. Mak boleh nangis dengar lagu tu. Oh, nangis tu bang. Best lah bang, lagunya menyayat hati. Mak cakap gini. Dia bilang, Shima, dia bilang, ini lagu. Kau tengok, dia bilang, kalau kita panjang umur, dia bilang gini. Walaupun 30-40 tahun akan datang, dia bilang gini, orang masih kenang lagu-lagu ini.
But it was during another of the film's songs, Jeritan Batinku, where Ramlee played the saxophone that had audiences captivated across the country. Even though Ramlee had mimed the part, he did it so well that to this day, many still believe that he was an accomplished saxophonist.
First kali film dia, Ibu Mertuaku, dia main saxophone. Tapi banyak orang bilang dia yang main. Actually bukan, he cannot play saxophone. Yang main dalam Ibu Mertuaku, Usop B. Tapi because P. Ramlee is a manusia yang luar biasa, sebab dia pegang piano kan, dia pegang violin kan, exactly like him play saxophone, the key semua betul.
The film won him an award for a specially created category at the Tokyo 10th Asian Film Festival in 1963, the most versatile talent. It was one of the highest recognitions yet for Malay cinema, and with this win, P. Ramlee's accomplishments as a filmmaker at the Shaw Studio were unparalleled. But on his return from the Tokyo Festival, the reception Ramlee got at the airport was in stark contrast to his previous wins. His return this time was met only by three studio staff, Saloma, and his personal assistant, Ramlee Jr. He had come home to a highly charged situation between the studio and the union. The union's restriction of working hours had delayed the delivery of Ibu Mertuaku, forcing Ramlee to pay for the crew's overtime claims from his own pocket. The meticulous director found it tough to meet Shaw's one picture every 4 months demand, with limited shooting time and lack of scriptwriters.
Satu shot tu kadang sampai satu malam dia ambil. Dia nak sesuaikan background projector tu dengan orang tu kan, manager tu semua. Especially when they close up tu, itu pakai lens yang paling bagus punya lens tu. Dia import lens tu kan, dia tu tu dia jaga close up tu, dia beli lens tu, dia suruh show beli lens tu. Kadang-kadang gambar dia bikin nak masuk festival 6 bulan.
Penalized for the union's actions, Ramlee felt that his efforts and dedication were unappreciated. He began to get disenchanted with the studio. The lack of scriptwriters forced P. Ramlee, like most directors, to adapt from other stories. But he gave the audience what they wanted with simple but clever plots.
Ramlee is a very good man for Chedo, you know. Well, number one fellow, very clever, and nobody can see it. Even Lagu also like that. But nobody will know, you know, what he has done. He's a wonderful chap, intelligent.
Ramlee created some of his best cinematic magic, and although he was far from content with the studio, the Shaws gladly continued to invest in him and gave him bigger budgets for bigger movies.
Kau boleh tahu siapa yang gambar yang mahal.
Satu saya cakap kau tahu. P. Ramlee lah. Especially dia beset. Kadang-kadang dia beset murah-murah dia kasi. Dua hari sudah habis boleh bikin satu set. Kadang-kadang tak ada. 8 hari, 10 hari mau bikin dia beset satu set.
Terrible at handling his own money, Ramlee asked Quek to deal with his finances and trusted him implicitly.
Kena saya masuk ke bank. Nah, dia nak apa-apa, saya keluar kan, kasih sama dia. Hey, Ramlee, kau tak? Kau kasih sama saya simpan duit, kau tak hitung. Apa, Mr. Quek ni cakap macam budak-budak lah. Dia cakap sama kita itu macam, dia kata, Mr. Quek kalau mau pakai ambil, dia kata. Duit dia banyak lah, termakan tak habis. Itu je dia tak betul punya bini yang tak tahu apa, saya tak teman-teman tanya dia.
According to Quek, they worked crazy hours to complete Ramlee's films quickly because they were guaranteed hits.
Kalau saya tahu ke, bukan main bagus lagi dia main gambar, duit masuk bukan main banyak, kau tak nak? Habis kalau dia nak apa sikit lebih kurang, kau tak boleh kasih? Tak boleh lah. Saya kalau tak kasih sama dia, saya rasa... Huh?
Continued success with his comedic films culminated in P. Ramlee winning his next and last international award for the film entitled Madhu Tiga. In 1963, Shaw offered P. Ramlee the chance to direct his first color film entitled Senewati in Hong Kong. He was also to direct his fifth sequel of the renowned Bhujang Lapok comedic series there. P. Ramlee was ecstatic, but the excitement was short-lived. Without telling Ramlee, the powerful union demanded higher payments and allowances for Ramlee and his co-stars, forcing Shaw to cancel the production of both films. Ramlee was bitterly disappointed. It was a time when Singapore was facing heightened left-wing radical trade union activities, and strikes at the Shaw studios were attracting the state's attention.
Bila Perdana Menteri apa ni Lee Kuan Yew dapat tahu buat union ni, jadi dia tak suka Melayu-Melayu ni buat union. So dia bilang dengan Shaw Brothers, you better close down. So Shaw Brothers kata dia, you better go to Merdeka Film.
Disillusioned, P. Ramlee moved to Merdeka Studio in 1964 after directing his last film, Tiga Abdul. He skipped the film's preview and saw it during its Kuala Lumpur run in the cinemas. Shaw Studio manager Quek Chip Jian had his own theory as to why P. Ramlee left the Shaw Studio in Singapore.
Kita biar orang tak suruh dia pergi, dia tak pergi sebenarnya. Kau tahu itu yang panggil sama dia siapa? Itu Tauke panggil dia sana. Kasi punya orang tu. Nama dia Ho Ano. Dia cakap sama P. Ramlee, apa kau nak? What do you think of that? Apa kau nak?
Merdeka Studio was owned by Ho Ah Luk and businessman H.M. Shah and managed by the Shaw family. P. Ramlee's absence was greatly felt at the Shaw Studios in Singapore. To his friends, P. Ramlee was like a bright star that shone on them. He helped to launch the careers of many. His departure left a deep void in their lives.
Saya ini seolah-olah macam anak ayam kehilangan ibu. Paksa saya struggle sendirilah. Kalau tidak ada P. Ramlee, tak adalah Kasim Mazdu.
Kalau dia sitting, saya cukup hormat dia director.
He is a very good actor. Very good actor. Dia kalau ada dekat sini, semua happy lah. Dia nanti cakap macam-macam, dia menyanyi macam gila. Shooting pun senang lah, dia orang semua suka lah. Bila dia tak ada, senyum. Senyap saja.
The Shaws, however, did not completely sever their ties with P. Ramlee. They later acquired a significant stake in Merdeka Studio.
Dia begini, dekat Kuala Lumpur ni, peralatan studio, barangnya tak cukup. Barangnya barang lama. Barang yang tak habis, yang Singapura dah tak boleh pakai, baru dibawa Kuala Lumpur. Macam kamera, lighting apa. Kedua, orang belum mahir. Macam di Singapura, orang dah mahir. Semua dah 10 tahun kerja. Kat sini semua orang baru.
P. Ramlee had thrived under the system at Shaw Studio. Backed by a highly experienced production team, he could concentrate wholly on the creative aspects of his work. But the state of things at Madeka Studio was very different. Tucked away beside a zoo with outdated equipment and inexperienced production staff, Ramli joked with friends that he was working in a zoo and was about to be eaten alive by a tiger. Ironically, Sitora Harimau Jadian, or Sitora the Were-Tiger, became the title of his first movie at Merdeka Studio. He tried dabbling in special effects, but with a small budget and poor support services, he had to multitask, even doing his own editing. The film came out technically inferior. At the film's preview in Singapore, attended by actors Ahmed Daud and Sadia, the Shaw brothers walked out after only 15 minutes.
Masa kita sendiri tengok introduction dengan jerk, editing jerk, kejap dia buat diri jadi Frankenstein.
Ramli would never again replicate the spectacular success he achieved at the Shaw Studio.
Dia orang janji macam-macam, nak kasi dia buat color film, nak buat canggih-canggih lah, cinemascope. Tapi bila dia sampai sini, tak ditepatkan janji, dia dah kecewa. Jadi dia punya creation bila bikin film dah tak gairah macam di Jalan Ampas.
The advent of television, Hollywood, Hong Kong and color Hindi films sounded the death knell of P. Ramlee's attempt to reinvent himself. P. Ramlee directed and acted in 18 more films for Madeka Studio until 1970, including the popular Do Re Mi trilogy. The comedic series was meant to recreate his popular Bujang Lapok characters, but it failed to capture their innocence and lovable ineptitude. Laxmana Do Re Mi was the last film P. Ramlee directed for Madeka Studio. At home, P. Ramlee lived happily with Saloma and their five adopted children. His only biological son, Nasir, had married and left home at 19. Ramlee realized that however dedicated he was to his work, he needed the emotional anchoring that only his family could provide. They meant the world to him.
Dia sayang betul anak-anak dia. Dia suka pijak baring, dia telah apa, tiarap kat sini. Nanti anak-anak dia dipanggil lah, pijak lah. Yang Sazali, yang Picit lah, yang si Sabarudin tu kan pijak. Jajah, pijak. Dengan saya-saya sekali pijak dia. Picit-picit dia. Itulah dia kesukaan.
His son Sazali was his biggest fan.
Otak dia macam dikunyul tuan luar biasa. Tengoklah anak dia sendiri pun tadi ikut jejak dia. Daddy saya, dia segak, handsome. Saya tak handsome.
Ramli liked to pamper his children, but he would be very strict when it came to music and schoolwork.
Dia kalau ajar dengan anak-anak dia memang serius. Baik kira-kira pelajaran sekolah maupun muzik. Dia tak boleh main-main. Dia boleh dah pukul saya, dia pujuk saya balik lah.
P. Ramli tried to teach Nasir and Sazali to play the piano, but quick-tempered Ramli would get really annoyed when they played badly. He would thump them both, but according to Nasir, it was him who usually got it worse.
Jadi mangsa saya lah. Bapak yang bergeram, saya kena. Tapi kalau orang buat hal, saya kena. P. Ramli mesti cari saya juga. Pukul saya bukan pukul, pukul teruk-teruk kan.
Satu hari saya tengok, saya pergi rumah dia, tengok dia tengah pukul Nasir. Pasal rambut panjang. Dulu Nasir rambut panjang. Bila saya sampai, dia stop. Dia tak dipukul Nasir.
Despite Ramli's domestic upheavals, Ahmed Nawa, Ramli's longtime friend, was privy to the star's other eccentricities.
Dia punya favorite tu timikai. Timikai dengan kicap. And then dia taruh cili kering. Sikit, ada cecah. Every time dia datang, dia call, dia kata, Ahmad, aku nak datang rumah. Saya prepare tu lah. And then dia punya favorite gunting rambut. Yang jadi mangsa je Nasir lah. Dia gunting, macam mana passion.
At home, when Ramli felt like eating a particular cuisine, he would call up Mariani, his sister-in-law, who he was once in love with.
Ramli ni dia very loving. dia tak suka Saloma kerja teruk-teruk di rumah, macam masak-masak, sibuk-sibuk semua. Dia adakan orang gaji. Dia nak Saloma sentiasa make up aja, cantik, duduk buat tatting, buat labuci, gitu aja. Dia tak suka macam Saloma kerja-kerja. Yang kena dera saya lah. Nah, bila nak masak lauk yang kesukaan dia, saya kena datang lah masakkan dia. Saloma duduk dan diam cantik aja. Gitu. Itu dia punya perangai. Si Ramli punya perangai.
Pampering Saloma was Ramli's way of showing his love for her and keeping his family together. This was important to Ramli, who felt that he had already lost one family, his friends at Shaw Studio in Singapore, whom he still missed dearly. In 1967, after three consecutive box office flops since Ramli's departure, Shaw Studio on Jalan Ampas ceased production for good. It was the era of the swinging 60s and the world invasion of rock, soul, pop, reggae, and blues music. The Bee Gees, the Rolling Stones, the Beatles, and the Supremes all became household names, displacing P. Ramlee's brand of music and singing style. And while local pop singers struggled to compete with the new musical craze, P. Ramlee remained true to his music. The consequences were disastrous.
P. Ramlee pernah kena bu di stage di Dewan Bahasa Pusaka. Waktu tu malam tiga Ramli, P. Ramli, A. Ramli, A. Ramli, saya kameraman. Jadi bila P. Ramli nak keluar menyanyi, semua orang bu. Saya tengok waktu pop di stadium, penyanyi Singapura dengan Malaysia, bila penyanyi Malaysia keluar, mesti orang bu. Jadi orang tak suka waktu tu penyanyi tempatan.
But these incidents only served to strengthen Ramli's resolve to promote the preservation of traditional Malay music.
Lagu-lagu macam lagu joget, orkes combo, lagu-lagu asli, ghazal dan dendang sayang ini tidak pernah dipertandingkan atau ditunjukkan. Kalau lagu-lagu ini tidak diberi galakan, maka nusaya lagi 10-20 tahun akan datang, lagu ini akan dilupa terus. Dan muzik-muzik dari barat, mereka akan mewakili diri kita.
Masa berjauhan, apa nanti kenang, bila dipahamkan, itulah saya.
By this time, P. Ramlee's son Nasir was making his own way in the music industry. But Ramli was disappointed at what he saw as Nasir's lack of music and acting skills. It was a sensitive subject that often left them on non-speaking terms. Nasir lamented having to live up to public expectations of him as P. Ramli's son whenever he performed.
Ayah yang beban satu je, bila ada show orang panggil ayah nyanyi, orang mesti compare. Oh, tak macam bapak dia pun. What should I nyanyi style I? Bukan nak ikut Ramli. Tak macam bapak dia lah. Alamak, sakit hati dengan aku lah.
P. Ramli made it clear he had no interest in Nasir's brand of music. But Nasir caught him hiding behind a pillar at the Merlin Hotel to watch him play one night.
Minta air dekat apa? Saya nampak, saya tahu dari dia P. Ramli. Dia buat macam ni lah. Saya membuat, jadi. Dia dengan baru nak baik tu.
As their love-hate relationship continued, P. Ramli felt his son slipping further away from him.
Dia dengan Nasir ni kurang sikit, kurang rapat. Tidak duduk, cerita apa, tak ada. Dia yang rapat betul Zazali. Termasuk bila datang si Zazaloma, dia rapat dengan Zazaloma. Bila datang Sabarudin, dia rapat dengan Sabarudin. Sebab-sebabnya saya tak tahu, kemungkinan lah mengikut cerita Kasma Buti. Junaidah ni tinggal Nasir begitu aja. Dia tinggal begitu aja dengan P. Ramli. Sekarang P. Ramli nak syuting, tak ada orang nak jaga. Yang jaga ni, lepas tu baru dihantar ke Penang. Jadi tidak apa, tak bersama.
Sebenarnya Nasir sama bapak dia pun ada clash. Clash pasal kahwin aja lah. Tapi ini cerita tak boleh kita terangkan lah.
Nasir was not the only relationship Ramlee held dear that seemed to be slipping away. In 1968, Ramlee's longtime recording company, EMI, decided not to renew his contract when it ended. It was a big shock to P. Ramlee.
Mr. Dewan kata dia, I don't think, saya tak ingat EMI want to do your recording sebab you punya lagu dah tak laku lagi dah. And then you punya voice pun orang tak terima. So waktu tu saya tengok muka dia merah dah. I feel so upset tengok P. Ramlee make so much money for EMI. Then dia boleh cakap begitu.
P. Ramlee swore he would never again work with EMI under any circumstances. It was the ingratitude that stung him more than the rejection. Ramlee concentrated on his films, doing everything he could to reach out to his audience. He introduced significant changes to his themes and portrayed multiracial settings in Sesudah Subo and Gerimis, but the audience was not moved. Then he tried a Hitchcock-style thriller in Dr. Rushdie and even a raunchy theme in Gelora, but the audience was too besotted with foreign movies to notice. Rejected for his singing, acting and directing, Ramlee's humiliation was complete. With one fell swoop, his status had changed from idol to fallen star.
Bini show mengok tunjuk pada P. Ramlee surat tu, kontrak P. Ramlee tidak boleh disambung lagi. Sign oleh Jaafar Abdullah.
Jaafar Abdullah, a Shaw organization executive, also said in the letter that P. Ramlee was a has-been and his movies were no longer selling.
Ada satu kawan abang masuk kerja di Shaw Brother, dapat photostat kan surat tu, abang dapat baca. Memang surat tu betul-betul macam nak membunuh P. Ramlee.
P. Ramlee punya filem sentiasa laku. Yalah, dia nak perkecilkan dia. Katalah macam-macam kan. Shaw lah yang start ni.
1972-73 were Ramlee's darkest days. With hardly any acting, directing, composing or singing jobs offered to him, he was desperate to find the means to support his family. P. Ramlee sang at weddings with Saloma, acted as compere for stage shows and became a judge for acting competitions to make ends meet. Nasir did not realize how broke his father was.
Saya pun kadang-kadang jumpa dia, dia tak pernah bilang yang dia susah apa, dia act normal kan, jadi saya tak tahu nak predict macam mana dia.
Dia tak pernah cerita dia punya kesusahan, macam mana susah dia pun dia. Dia pendam ke? Ini P. Ramlee.
Yet Ramlee's critics were relentless. There was very little sympathy for him. The Ramlee skeptics among the journalists were almost gloating in their review of his fall from grace.
P. Ramlee memang kecewa dengan wartawan. Kecewa dengan saya sendiri pun kadang-kadang saya nak jumpa dia pun susah, dia malas nak jumpa wartawan. Kan? Apabila ada satu peringkat tu, dia ada dalam studio tu. Dia tengah mengubah lagu, mencipta lagu kan. Apabila saya masuk dengan wartawan tu, dia lari. Dia tak nak jumpa.
But P. Ramlee was fortunate to have found a friend, fan and benefactor in businessman Dato H.M. Shah. They set up a Malaysian film enterprise called Perfima. The plan was for P. Ramlee to direct his long-awaited color film. They brought in five more members into Perfima. The company brought new hope to P. Ramlee. He had dreamed of setting up P. Ramlee Film Productions, his own film company, to rival the Shaw Studio one day. But Ramlee was in for another disappointment.
Bila bangunan itu dah siap, hari pertama, P. Ramlee dengan Cem Shah diberhentikan, dikeluarkan daripada Perfima.
The majority of Perfima decided that its first color film project would not be directed by P. Ramlee, but a younger director, Jin Shamsuddin, who had just completed a film course in London. Ramlee felt totally dejected and defeated.
Mana Perfima jadi? Kalau kita ada dalam tu, insyaAllah jadi. Pasal ada, kita ada pengalaman, ada duit. Macam diorang tak ada apa-apa. Pengalaman aja. Pengalaman tak ada duit, tak jadi.
P. Ramlee was at the lowest point in his career. Putting food on the table for his family was a daily struggle. He was forced to do whatever he could to earn a living.
Pasal masa tu dia sudah buat kedai, warung untuk main maju. So he is living on the pendapatan the maju, you know, table money. So makin lama makin turun.
Ramlee was embarrassed when his childhood friend Sukardi found him at the Mahjong store. He tried to hide his embarrassment by showing his annoyance with Sukardi.
Dia marah dekat dia, tegur juga dekat dia. Jadi dia pun marah juga dekat saya lah pasal saya tak duduk sebelah dia. Dia kalau kita jumpa kena duduk dia, dakap dia. Cerita dalam setengah jam, lari tak apa. Ni pasal saya nak pergi meeting dengan uniform pula, mana boleh duduk kedai macam.
To help his boss, his long-time personal assistant Ramlee Jr. approached a small recording company.
Fu Chok Wan tulis cek 1,000 bagi P. Ramlee, buat 4 lagu.
Ramlee wrote the songs and Saloma's sister Mimi Loma recorded them as Saloma was still contracted to EMI. But P. Ramlee was eager to produce his first color film and tried to obtain a bank loan to finance it. But he was rejected at every turn.
Habis semua, semua apa dia buat, dia pergi minta bantuan semua tak dapat tau. Padahal working paper dia very good tau. Bank tak percaya. Dia dengar pasal, yelah P. Ramlee tu jam dah jatuh, siapa nak percaya lagi, siapa nak bagi duit kan buat. Dia dah no good already.
Semua orang boleh tolong dia. Banyak orang boleh tolong dia. Kerajaan boleh tolong dia. Dia biasa mengadap ini orang, ini orang. Semua kira macam tepis, tepis, tepis.
And even the TV and radio stations had nothing to offer him.
Waktu itu saya kerja RTM Orkestra itu jam 17 tahun. Saloma dapat program. Jadi dia teman Saloma ni pergi menyanyi tapi dia tunggu kat kantin. Let's see, how sad P. Ramlee met life waktu tu. Tapi he's a singer. Dia tenas, dia boleh dapat satu program P. Ramlee show ke apa. Nobody cares.
P. Ramlee may have had few friends left who cared, but in the bleakness of it all, he found a beacon of hope. P. Ramlee struggled to put the pain of his disappointments behind him, but his friend and benefactor H.M. Shah continued to support him. They set up another company called Rumpun Melayu. Ramlee, assisted by Ramlee Jr., concentrated on the company's cinema renovation project and acquiring films for screening by Rumpun Melayu. They operated from an office at Shah Motel owned by H.M. Shah. But it was a visibly depressed P. Ramlee who made what was to be his last trip to Singapore for the Asia Pacific Film Festival in 1973. As usual, he put on a happy face visiting old friends and sharing precious moments with them. His film, Laxmana Do Re Mi, was nominated for the festival. But the reception he got was a far cry from his golden years when he was the toast of the festival.
Bila P. Ramlee masuk, tak ada satu orang pun bangun mempelawa atau membawa P. Ramlee duduk dekat delegate Malaysia. Kemudian dia nampak saya, dia terus duduk belakang saya kat Singapore delegate.
While P. Ramlee was ignored by local film participants, those from overseas were queuing up to meet him.
Yang daripada pelakon-pelakon luar negeri ni, tak ada jumpa pelakon-pelakon kita lah. Siapa saya tak jumpa. Tapi semua orang cari P. Ramlee. Hong Kongnya lah, Indonesia Bing Selamat pun cari P. Ramlee juga.
Ramlee savored the moment, socializing with the delegates who had sought him out. For a while, he looked like the old Ramlee, who was friendly with everyone and loved to chat. When he called on old friends from the Shaw studio days, they noticed he was depressed, wondering if people had forgotten or just disliked him.
Saya terus jawab, Ram, jangan kata mereka. Biar berjuta lagi manusia tak sayang sama lu pun tak apa.
asal Allah sayang sama lu cukup dalam.
Dato' jawab, abang, you will be remembered forever, forever, forever.
Ya, dia kata, orang dah tak peduli saya. Saya punya karya pun orang dah tak suka saya. Saya dah tua lah, saya dah tua lah, dia cakap. Saya ndak filem Melayu ni akan apa cantik lagi, maju lagi macam luar negeri. Tapi saya tak sampai, cita-cita saya tak sampai. Saya kecewa, dia cakap.
For actor Aziz Sattar, to whom P. Ramlee was a mentor and successful movie icon, Ramlee's aura of dejection felt strange. But he was shocked to see Ramlee's true financial situation in Kuala Lumpur.
Hidup dia melarat, nah. Kesian. Last saya pergi rumah dia, saya tengok. Dia makan nasi dengan telur. Nama dia besar. Orang tahu Piramli siapa. Tapi hidup dia melarat.
But Ramlee was not one to wallow in self-pity, especially in the company of friends. He didn't bear grudges.
P. Ramlee ni saya tahu, dia 61 dia tak pernah condemn ini pelakon-pelakon lain. Ini tak pernah cerita pelakon-pelakon lain, iri-iri hati semua tak ada. Dia suka happy ya. And then he like to cerita yang lucu-lucu lah.
Ramlee's friends say they could sit all night having coffee with him at the food stalls, enjoying his self-deprecating humor and stories about his life. But they all agree on P. Ramlee's one exasperating trait. He couldn't say no to anyone asking for help. It became his own undoing.
Kalau dia ada duit, katakan duit tu ada 200 kat dalam kocik. Satu hari orang datang. Orang kata, bang, saya susah ni nak balik kampung. Mak saya sakit, tak ada duit. Iyakah? Semua dia kasih. 200 tu dia kasih. Saloma tercegak. Saloma cakap, saya ada hari tu. Saloma cakap, Daddy, kenapa Daddy kasih semua? Kan ini hari-hari Minggu. Mana ada bank? Dulu mana ada ATM kan? Tak apa. Itu rezeki dia. Saya tak apa.
Allah Ya Rahmi, dia tak boleh tengok orang susah. Orang putak belit dengan dia. Terma, siapa tak boleh pukul dia.
He was also generous in his professional life. Even when he was already a big name, he willingly shared top billing with his co-stars, often reviving other people's flagging careers. It was actress Sarima who was discovered and nurtured by Ramlee 10 years earlier that still believed in his talents and asked him to direct her new film.
Sehari sebelum dia meninggal tu, saya, arwah suami saya, kita ada dekat Shah Motel. Dan memang nak tawar dia, saya dah lupa apa tajuknya cerita tu, dan memang dia setuju.
The offer from Sarima and her husband filled P. Ramlee with a new optimism. But P. Ramlee was never again to set foot on a film set. Before dawn on the 29th of May 1973, P. Ramlee had a heart attack at home. Saloma accompanied him in the ambulance to the Kuala Lumpur hospital. Their son, Sazali, waited at home with the younger children. A few hours later, Sazali received the dreaded call from Saloma. He refused to believe her at first.
Betul, mama dah suruh doktor dah tiga kali pam dah, dia punya dada dah. Doktor cakap meninggal. Habis kita pun dapat tahu. Orang gaji dengan adik-adik menangis lah.
Sazali, who was 15 then, recalls his father's last words to him just before the heart attack.
Jaga mama baik-baik. Dia kata, jaga adik-adik elok. Jangan tinggal mama, apa sekalipun terjadi. Kalau kecuali mama dah tak ada lagi, kau nak pergi, pergilah. Tapi pergi dengan cara baik.
P. Ramlee, a great man and a true genius, had died far before his time. He was the original hero of the Malay film world, his brilliance and kindness an inspiration to many. The news of P. Ramlee's death at the age of 44 was met with disbelief.
Saya lemah bila dengar dia meninggal, lemah tenaga ni, air mata ni bercucur. Belakang saya cakap dengan Saloma lah, kita nak turun, kita nak tengok mayat dia. Saloma tak kasih tengok. Dia bilang, Piramli pesan dia tak nak tengok siapa pun dia mati. Ha, itu kita kecil hati sikitlah dengan Saloma.
Saya dengar kat radio Piramli meninggal kan. Saya terus pergi rumah dia. Minta jam belum ada lagi orang ramai tengok dia. Tapi mayat dia saya tengok betul-betul dia senyum tu.
When his first son Nasir heard the news, he wasn't sure how to react. He couldn't believe it at first.
Tapi bila saya tengok mayat di atas simen itu baru saya pun. Datang doktor dulu, tolak mata dia, tolak hidung yang mana. Doktor saya marah dia orang pun. Tak apa nak bedah pun, tak bagi bedah. No, leave him one piece saja.
Nasir said Saloma was in a daze throughout the funeral. She acted as if everything was normal.
Dia lawan juga. Tapi dia betul lebih ramai.
Dia cinta sejati. Sebelum dia meninggal, dia cakap dengan saya, "Ya, aku nak mati dah. Tak nak hidup lagi." "Apa kau cakap ni?" cakap. "Buat apa aku nak hidup? Daddy dah tak ada," dia kata. "Kau tolonglah, bila aku dah mati nanti, kau kuburkan aku kat sebelah dia."
Saloma was quoted in the newspapers as saying after P. Ramlee's death, "Even if I were to die and somehow live again, I would never find a husband as good as P. Ramlee." When Saloma died, almost 10 years after P. Ramlee, Mariani kept her promise to her sister. She made sure they were together, side by side, in their final resting place.
Tiba-tiba dia bersuara kat saya, "Haji, kalau gua mati, gua akan hidup 1,000 tahun lagi, Jis."
The sudden death of P. Ramlee, the greatest star of the Malay entertainment world at the age of 44, came as a complete shock to Malaysians. For close friends, his death had only just begun to sink in. They started to recall how oddly he had behaved before he died.
Jadi selegan ni datang jumpa saya. Apa? Dia maki rumah. Dia baliknya rumah sial. Nak balik makan nasi tak ada. Nasi yang sebenar selama saya duduk rumah Pilandi tak pernah tak ada. Pada itu hari tak ada nasi.
Dia selalu baik dengan saya bila saya datang. Hari tu saya datang nak jenguk Saloma. Dia rampas Melissa umur 6 bulan. Dia bawa pergi belakang. Dia tak nak cakap dengan saya. Malam tu dia meninggal.
Ramlee's son, Nasir, believed he had a premonition of his father's death.
I dah habis kerja, I balik rumah. Dalam pukul 4 lebih, I macam orang tumbuk perut air ni, I cakap, "Kerana Allah tak bohong, eh." Macam orang tumbuk perut air tau. I terus bangun tau. "Alamak, apa pasal ni?" Macam tu, I tidur balik. Pagi tu, polis datang ketuk pintu.
Ramlee's close friends attributed his heart attack to the anxiety of a recent court summons.
Yang dia meninggal ni pun pasal dia terkejut. Dia jamin satu hamba Allah. Jadi besoknya tu ada kes lah.
Waktu dia belum meninggal 3-4 hari saya jumpa dia lah. Dia kena pikot kan. Ada dia kena saman kan. Janggut pun ada. Dia susah hati. P. Ramlee ni yang saya tahu dia takut doktor. Dia tak pernah pergi doktor. Yang satu dia takut orang saman dia.
On the day of the funeral, Ramlee Jr., his long-time personal assistant, was worried.
Sebab itu, waktu dia meninggal, saya susah hati. Saya cakap Saloma, "Kak, macam mana ni, Kak? Nak ke bumi, Kak?" Saya takut tak ada orang. Saya takut tak ada orang. Pasal waktu itu memang tak ada kawan. Tak adalah siapa datang rumah dia tanya. Memang dia susah betul. Hari itu memang tak ada. Hari dia meninggal memang tak ada duit. Termasuk Saloma pun tak ada. Tak ada duit. HM Shah bantu semua HM Shah. HM Shah bagi RM3,000 pada Saloma.
Ramlee Jr. couldn't have been more wrong. Hundreds of people thronged the house, mosque and burial grounds to pay their last respects to P. Ramlee. On the 29th of May 1973, in the burial grounds in Kuala Lumpur, the world said goodbye to P. Ramlee for the last time. Today, the memory of P. Ramlee is fiercely and loyally protected by a nation that can't quite forgive itself for the way he was treated and will not tolerate any criticism of him.
Kau paper keluar hentam P. Ramlee gini. Masih jawab lah, tak payah juga. Besok banyak orang lain jawab hentam dia balik. So, dia orang hantar lah.
When it came out that neither Ramlee nor any Malaysian owned the rights to his films, many were emotionally crushed. His films could not be screened locally without permission from the owners, the Shaw organization. While others continued to profit from his films, P. Ramlee's family was completely left out.
Ini semua kita punya property. All ours.
Concerned organizations in the Malaysian entertainment industry helped his family gain copyrights to some of his songs. This is the only legacy of P. Ramlee that belongs to them. According to Nasir, his father had planned to use the royalties from his songs to perform the Hajj to Makkah.
Did I plan? Dengan Salomon nak pergi the world sampai pergi haji sekali dia bang.
But by the time the royalties came through, Ramlee had passed away.
Mari kita berdendam.
To P. Ramlee's legion of loyal fans, brand P. Ramlee is very much alive beyond the realm of copyright.
Hatiku penuh godaan.
Ramlee composed over 390 songs in his lifetime, his music recognized all around the world. In more recent years, younger generations of Malaysian singers have re-recorded P. Ramlee's songs with varying success.
Kau laksana bulan, tinggi di atas kayangan. Hatiku dah kau tawan, hidupku tak karuan. Saya sendiri pun bila sampaikan lagu Allahyarham Tan Sri P. Ramlee ini, rasanya sampai menusuk ke dalam jiwa lah kalau kita menyanyi.
To his loyal fans, however, Ramlee breathed a certain life into his songs, stirring the heart of anyone listening to them.
Sebenarnya lagu-lagu itu tak boleh dimodernkan. Sebab lagu itu dah, itulah asal dia, dia punya, itulah karakter P. Ramlee. Katalah Mona Lisa punya painting, dia cuba nak buat tambah color. Cannot. That's a work of the people you must respect.
P. Ramlee had no formal education in music, yet he rose to become one of the greatest musicians in the country. He wanted music to be taught from an early stage in Malaysian schools, so the passion and love for traditional music would be inspired from young and never forgotten.
Kalau kita tidak semaikan music, tradisional asli ini ke dalam dada anak-anak kita, anak muda kita, usai hari satu hari muzik lain akan mengambil tempat, kerana di dalam dada mereka itu kosong, tidak ada apa-apa. Semua juga macam kita mengajar anak kita pergi belajar agama, walau bagaimanapun dia pergi berapa tinggi pun dia jarang hendak menukar agama, kerana agama yang telah diajar oleh bapaknya telah tersimpan dalam dada dia. Itu juga muzik, supaya muzik lain tak boleh mempengaruhi jiwanya.
Cinematically, Ramlee is most fondly remembered for his portrayal of the innocent, downtrodden hero, or the charming, mischievous playboy, his own wicked sense of humor often permeating his films. His last film, Laksmana Do Re Mi, was a spoof of his own losing battle for viewership. It was probably the lowest budget film he ever made, but he and his co-stars had the time of their lives doing the spoof.
Zam zam alakazam.
Ramli's influence on Malay popular culture today remains unstoppable. Even in death, his magic finds its way into the hearts of successive generations of Malaysians.
Menipu untuk kepentingan diri.
Kabardar, Jaya Sing King Sahab.
Banyak yang kita boleh pelajari daripada karya-karya beliau dan kenapa dia masih boleh ada entertainment value yang sangat tinggi. Segi-segi dialog dia yang tidak pernah waste. Tak pernah wasted, kita pasti dengar, ingat, segar dengan kita.
Without P. Ramlee, Malaysia would be very different, I think. He set very high standards for all of us. Can your song be as good as a P. Ramlee song? Can your movie be as good as a P. Ramlee movie?
Decades later, there is still no substitute for Malaysia's charismatic genius.
Semua dia bikin sendiri. Bikin skrip, mengarah, berlakon, cipta lagu, editing. Saya tak fikir kita dapat lagi satu P. Ramlee lah.
Memang tak ada orang tolak banding, tak ada orang boleh ganti tempat dia. Tak ada orang boleh ganti tempat dia.
Tiada kata secantik bahasa untuk ku puji adinda. Tiada gambar secantik lukisan untuk ku tunjuk perasaan.